go off, give me a holler, because that means I need to change the batteries.
Okay.
But I'll you don't have to.
Keep an eye on it.
Just, it's dumb. I suppose some people actually watch them.
I would.
He brought up E.F. Schumacher, Prince Kropotkin, K-R-O-P-P-O-T-I-N.
What's the second one?
Prince.
Okay, so Schumacher, if he's the one I'm thinking of, is a contemporary of Hegel's in Berlin. And he's primarily a theologian, but he was very interested. And kind of was the liberal theologian.
Windelberry.
But that might have been Schleiermacher. So maybe these are contemporaries. I don't know Schumacher or.
He says they're not like formally philosophers, but they're philosophers.
Well, yeah, I think that's a real puzzle. What do you mean by philosopher? I mean, if you take it strictly as lover of wisdom, who the heck isn't?
You kind of get the term philosopher after you go on. Right?
Yeah, I remember when the very first year I was here teaching in 95, and I asked the chair of the department, Bob Kuhner, because people started, like, someone said, "Oh, you're a philosopher." And I was like, whoa, that's an honorific that I dreamt not of, you know. Sorry, my Shakespeare's poor. But, you know, the odd thing was, whoa, it suddenly hit me. Why would teaching philosophy make me a philosopher? And then I realized, you know, that's what a lot of the other faculty call the members of the philosophy department are philosophers. That's weird, because normally you think of, well, he's a philosopher, as like someone who's earned amazing status in the light of, you know, the peers or whatever, you know. But on the other hand, it really does just mean anyone who loves learning stuff. So it's, you know, how is it used popularly? And what Bob Kuhner replied to me, I said to him, so, what do we call ourselves? And he says, a teacher. And I thought, yes, that's the easy way out. You know, although, when you're teaching philosophy and you start off with Socrates, who basically professes that anybody who calls himself a teacher is full of nonsense, how do you go from there? You know, it's like, you know, if you act like you've got any kind of wisdom to impart, you're obviously an egocentric blowhard. So no, you don't want to go there either.
So
it's actually still an embarrassment when people ask me, oh, you teach philosophy? And I go, well, they pay me. Actually, they pay Donna. She's
so for a term project, does it have to be from the list of philosophers?
No.
Okay.
No, that's more of I'm thinking most people have no clue who many of our contemporary philosophers are. So I post that list. But you can use all the ones, even though they're dead, the ones that we cover. We cover all the way up to contemporary people.
Okay,
like
so we
Descartes.
Can't be like too abstract with it. You want it to be actual, like a philosopher, like a person like that is known as a philosopher?
Well, if you picked like a topic and you wanted to hit a couple of folks, you could do that too.
Okay. Cool.
I think you asked about that, right?
Yeah, that'd definitely be like, I don't know, easier for, not easier, but more like interesting for me to more touch on a topic that was developed by multiple philosophers rather than just a person.
Yeah. Well, what I'm hoping for is that you're going to become familiar with someone, especially contemporary, but someone who really has answers to sort of all the questions, so it's like a complete philosophy that you can kind of get a sense that all these questions, even though in class and the way we approach them usually in a philosophy class is, you know, by throwing the question out there and letting you fend for yourself, basically, right? Because that's you know, of the Socratic method, right? You know, you ask the questions, but you don't, you know, you're the, what, the midwife, right? You know, so I'm helping you give birth to your ideas, basically. It's kind of Socrates' idea, right? But the thing is, if you're actually reading contemporary philosophers, of course they do give answers, usually coherent answers, if they're good ones, to all of the different questions. There are sides. So like a typical side would be Steven Pinker on the one hand and Stuart Hameroff on the other, who both have different sense and interpretation of the mind. You know? And one is more like Plato and the other one's more like Aristotle. You know, so there's interesting folks that still take sides, so there's no guaranteed answers on a lot of the big questions. On a lot of the what we think of today as smaller questions, of course, the reason they're smaller is because we have the answers. We now know that language is a significant part of what frames the way we view the world. There's no doubt about that as far as everyone is concerned. You know, we all kind of understand that the whole history of philosophy has kind of led up to these kinds of results. So there's a lot of contemporary stuff that's really, really good. You know, so that when you're sitting there and you're studying Plato and Aristotle and even Descartes and David Hume, you know, we know a ton of stuff today, more than they did, of course. We've got all kinds of new equipment that enables us to see the smaller and the larger in a way that they could never have possibly seen it. The size of the universe and the kinds of microbes and genes and particles and, you know, everything that goes into the kinds of contemporary answers we have, they could not have imagined, I don't think, that far into the future. Imagine what, I mean, even in the, say, the 50s, you know, when they're talking about science, they're guessing. They have no clue, you know, how things are going to be just 50, 60 years later, right? Science has been just absolutely amazing that way. I mean, none of them imagined the internet. None of them imagined YouTube or video or, you know, things of that sort, or shooting a sports car out into space just to test the rocket, you know.
NASA had a catalog that, because they catalog everything that's made in space, so I forgot they had its name, Tesla 1 or something like that, because it's out in orbit.
That's funny.
If you saw the video that was posted, they actually had music playing to go with it. While it was out there, of course. Jesus, what a creep. I can't believe it.
Next time they shoot something in space, they gotta watch out for the Tesla.
Yeah, you have to watch out for that. You might want to watch out for that. Just, there it goes.
Photos of the Tesla floating above Earth.
Yep. Selfies. You know, with
the New Horizon thing just broke the record for this photograph to transmit back to Earth.
Oh.
Broke that Voyager.
Well, that should just keep happening.
Yeah.
As long as it still works.
Yeah, as long as it can transmit. The Voyager's apparently still going out there. It just can't communicate.
Well, I remember them being even concerned, would it be able to go through the I forget what they called it, the shock wave or something of the sun, like the solar shock or whatever. There's like a ship traveling through the ocean where you have the bow wave. There's like a wave basically that the sun, actually the whole solar system, creates as it's going through, and they weren't sure if V'ger 1 or 2. One went off kind of to the left, the right. I don't know what directions that would be. Wouldn't be north, south, east, or west. It would both be towards Orion, I suppose. Too cool. But let's go look at David Hume. He picks up where Berkeley has left off with many of the same issues. David Hume is the one who's famously going to take British empiricism to its peak. And it doesn't go away, so British empiricism, in a sense, is still out there. Yes?
What is that exactly, British empiricism?
So empiricism
So the whole, you're not actually seeing it, you're getting particles in your eyes, that sort of thing?
Right. Now, Hobbes isn't listed here. Remember I mentioned that even though Hobbes was an empiricist, he's not officially one of the British empiricists, because the problem of British empiricism begins with Locke. And that's where he points out that, theoretically, we're not actually seeing, hearing, tasting, touching any of the objects themselves, in themselves, the things in themselves. Instead, we're reacting to how our senses react to the objects.
Okay.
So what we're seeing is what human beings see when they see the light coming from these objects. So that wall isn't really white.
You're just seeing
it. It looks white to us, under the right kind of color conditions and light conditions, of course, right? But in itself, the wall has no color. To a snake, it looks different. To a bat, I don't think it would see colors. It would pick up the sonar, or whatever you call it, radar, whatever, what the bats. Right. So strictly speaking, the experiences we have, according to Locke, are the secondary qualities of the thing, not the primary qualities of the thing.
Okay.
And so the problem is, we don't really know what the dang things are like in themselves. They're always modified by our perception of it. And by the way, that hasn't gone away, that problem, even though there are some that point out that, well, duh, that's what the thing is, the way it looks to us. So we are seeing it. Okay, that's another tool that we can have in our box. But the advantage of this tool is that, as we see today, that with quantum mechanics, perceiving something actually changes the relationship. So electrons show up where we look for them, not because they're there.
So would this be
where,
like,
we look for it, that's where it is.
Is this arguably like more scientific? So when talking about how Hume changed science, would it be sort of like how he more
absolutely
put in these sort of ideals, he put more of an empiricism look at science?
Yes. What he's going to do is take this problem. So Locke gives us the problem by saying we can't really see the things, but the material world is really there for Locke. Hence, if you say the tree really makes a noise even though there's no one there to hear it, that's Locke, I would say, right? On the other hand, if you say, well, the reason the tree is observed even though there's no person there, it's because God hears everything, that's Berkeley. But when you get to David Hume, I think the right way of phrasing the question is, what tree? If no one's there to hear, see, taste, touch, smell, you know, whatever, the tree. What event are you talking about? Because it hasn't been observed. And with Berkeley's argument that there's a God who sees everything, David Hume says, how do you know? And Berkeley really has no answer.
How do you know what?
That God knows, that there is a God. David Hume is an actual dyed-in-the-wool atheist says so and comes up with proofs, or counterproofs rather, to the proofs that there is a God. So
that's
which ones? Which ones? The ones that he focuses on are the cause and effect arguments, so the cosmological ones, right? So there's a chain of causes. There has to be a first cause. David Hume asks, theoretically, why can't right now be the first cause? How do you know that there was a prior chain of causality? You don't, except for what? Memory? History? But guess what? It turns out. Have you ever thought you remembered something and then didn't? We all have, right? David Hume points out memory is a fallible resource, so therefore you can't trust memory. So therefore, anything that depends on our memory for our knowledge is fallible, so we don't really know it. So for example, you are Macy, you are Emma, you're Brian. I'm not sure who I am, but that's because I've read you, I think. And the problem is, all of your previous states that you thought of as yourself are in your memory. And if you can't trust your memory, you can't trust that you are a persistent self. Plus, remember, Berkeley also points out you've, strictly speaking, never seen yourself or experienced yourself, because you're the subject of that experience.
So assuming that in like the 17th and 18th centuries, or like whenever Hume was like active,
1711 to 1776.
Okay.
Which we can all remember 1776, because that was a really great year for Pinot Noir.
So that was like still a religious time. So when he started like questioning those religious views, like, did people really catch on to it fast, or were people kind of like side-eyeing him at that?
Oh, yeah. They thought he's an atheist. In fact, the dumbest thing on his part was he applied to teach at a seminary. Or, you know, in a college that was essentially to produce ministers. And he's an avowed atheist. So they said, no. And he was like, dang. You know, you know, it's just...
That shouldn't have come as a surprise.
How smart are you, Hume? You know that you want to teach in a school that professes faith in God, and you are an avowed atheist?
Probably
of course
to,
they didn't hire you.
Probably wanted to like destroy the system from the inside type of thing. That's what it kind of sounds like.
His one job that he finally did get was as a librarian for the Edinburgh Library. And while he was there, that's when he wrote the book that became the most popular in his lifetime, and that was A History of England or Great Britain, which was it?
So far, it seems like Hume's really wrong skeptics.
Yes, he's considered the skeptic par excellence, the skeptic of skeptics. Because if you take this problem then, and you say, okay, well, I don't have memory to count on. So even the reason that these two books are here is I put them there. Based on my memory, so strictly speaking, I don't know that for sure. And you think, well, that is so dumb. Well, he wasn't actually impractical. What his target was those philosophers that thought that they had demonstrated something for sure, that this is absolute knowledge. And there is actual knowledge, but it's knowledge of abstract things, like 2 + 2 = 4, mathematical things are not based on empirical observation. Now, we could get into this, it's kind of interesting, and in fact, Kant was woken from his Wolfian rationalist slumbers. Rationalists are the opposite of the empiricists. They think all our knowledge comes from abstract things, like Plato. So Kant, who we'll do next, was a rationalist who followed the teachings of Christian Wolff. So he was a Wolffian rationalist, because they were rationalists, right? And he was so-called sleeping. That's in your text, actually. He first woke from his rationalist slumbers or Wolffian slumbers when he read the works of David Hume, not the history, but instead the treatise, right, which we have in the text. And that's what woke him when he realized Hume is right. And this was a problem, because if Hume is right, how can we even do metaphysics? So metaphysics then would be groundless. There would be no way you could prove anything if David Hume is right that we can't trust our memory. And what kinds of things will that affect? So, for example, cause and effect. If I'm playing pool or billiards. Hume is actually playing billiards. They didn't have pool. Don't know why that is. By the way, Kant plays billiards too. In fact, that's how he paid his way through college, by gambling in billiards. Immanuel Kant, he made money gambling on billiards, and that paid his tuition.
So,
just kind of a fascinating little tidbit.
So Kant initially didn't really like believe Hume's like theories on that, and then one day
he didn't know Hume's theories, but when he did have the chance to read them, and it was fairly late, it was like in his late 40s or early 50s that he first read David Hume's work, and all of a sudden he had a aha moment that all of his academic work was based essentially on rationalism, and it was basically undercut by David Hume's thesis, which meant that Kant had to deal with it. And so the famous question then is, has Kant answered Hume? Because Kant is going to do his best to solve the problem that David Hume sets for him, and that's what we'll talk about on Thursday. Which, by the way, makes that a really important class, because reaching Kant is like, well, if you're going to be a contemporary academic, you have to be a Kant, if you're in the know, an elite member of our society today, you have to at least be a Kantian. So please come, because that's really kind of an important step for us, right? Following that, you can do other things, but you have to at least be a Kantian, and then there are answers, of course. I mean, that's 1800, roughly 1790s. The 1790s is where Kant suddenly just dumps all these books out: the Critiques of Pure Reason, Critique of Practical Reason, Critique of Judgment, all just come out within like 8 years. In his like late 50s and early 60s. That's when he starts really. Before that, he wouldn't have been famous. He was just a typical Königsberg teacher, teaching what everybody there was teaching. But after that, Kant becomes significant for us, because he does kind of answer Hume. But so how? And so back to Poole, because here's, I think, a wonderful illustration of the problem. So if I'm playing pool, and I've got the rack all set up, and I take a shot at the eight ball. I line up the cue ball, line up, take a perfect shot, sink the eight ball. Called the shot and everything, so it's a good, right? I don't lose. I did it on purpose, right? Put the balls back exactly where they were. It's a good slate table. There's no earthquakes, no heavy gale winds in the basement, wherever your pool table is. Take the shot again exactly the same way. Same thing happens. Exact same thing, right? Do it again, right? This is, you know, what science says consistency. If you have the exact same cause, you get the exact same effect, right? But Hume says, well, actually, I'll extrapolate a little bit. Here I am, shooting the cue ball that's right at the eight ball. Just before it hits the eight ball jumps up in the air and says to the cue ball, ha ha, you can't get me. And the cue ball says, hey, you can't do that, and sinks into the pocket. What just happened?
Same cause had different effect?
At least in my imagination. In my imagination. In fact, that would have come from the movie Who Framed Roger Rabbit. But you never saw that.
Mm-mm.
Who Framed Roger Rabbit? It was a dumb movie. It was actually a cute movie where there was like real people, but they went into tunes. So like the world between cartoons and the real world were kind of like merged somehow, right? But so I would have went into a tune at that point. But the thing that David Hume points out is that if you can imagine something else happening besides the actual cause and effect relationship that we think of as necessary, then it isn't necessary. It's possible, at least in our imagination, for something else to happen. So what kind of necessity do we mean when we say that cause and effect is a necessary relationship, which, as far as I understand it, all the way up to this point throughout Western history, has been thought of as a necessary relationship? And Hume puts it into question. Says, well, what makes it necessity? Is it logical necessity? Well, if it's logical necessity, then you couldn't have had anything else happen. It would be a contradiction. And we couldn't hold a contradiction in our mind. You couldn't have imagined it. I'm not sure that that argument really works, but historically it does. Because people say, you're right. We can imagine something else happening. And so it can't be logical necessity that gives us the necessary character of cause and effect. So where does that necessity come from? And his answer is, well, as a matter of fact, necessity, as a matter of fact, it always happens that way. But how do we know it? That's the way we remember it always being in the past. But that is dependent on our memory being infallible, and our memories are not infallible. So therefore, there is no necessity. At least that we know to be the case. Now, practically speaking, you know, when I follow the directions and I, you know, put my hamburger on the plate in the microwave and it says 2 minutes, I push 2 minutes, and you know what? It's always good. I mean, my whole rest of my family say they're horrible hamburgers, but as far as I'm concerned, it's way neater than like frying it in a pan, et cetera, et cetera. And they're pre-cooked, so you just pop it out of the freezer, 2 minutes, bing, I've got a hamburger. Actually, I think they're way better than, well, I am recording this, certain vendors' hamburgers that you can locally purchase. You know, like McDonald's. Burger King. I don't know. So, this argument is supposed to have destroyed cause and effect as a necessary relationship. There are still necessary relationships that are between ideas. So the relationships between ideas, like if you're an unmarried male, you're also a bachelor. That's absolutely necessary. Because unmarried male means bachelor. And that becomes a famous thing. 7 + 5 = 12. That's absolutely necessary. But notice, strictly speaking, I don't have to perceive any empirical information to know that. Now, Kant, and I think I mentioned Kant in this regard specifically, because what Kant will focus in on is actually those relationships between ideas do enter into our minds through empirical events. Teachers teaching you 7 + 5 = 12. That's an empirical event. You don't actually learn it by just sitting at your desk and thinking, aha, 7 + 5 = 12. No, you actually have to have the empirical experience of learning how to count, etc., in order for you to know how to grasp those systems. And maybe you've never been told 7 + 5 = 12, you figured out for yourself, but you've been taught empirically the system so that you can then make those kinds of conclusions. So Kant is going to make actually the problem harder on himself before he makes it better. So that's kind of interesting. Another example of this would be, so that's cause and effect, cause and effect. You are wearing a blue shirt. You're wearing a blue jacket. And there's blue in your bag. There's something blue in all three of those places. They resemble one another, not completely. Their shapes are different, etc. But you agree that blues resemble one another in some sense, that they're blues, right? Well, what makes them resemble one another? You say
similar light
patterns. Similar light bouncing off similar particles. What makes the particles similar?
They're like one another.
They're like one another. When you get down to it, that means, well, their shape, their arrangement, their
composition.
Complex system arrangement is similar to one another. Well, what makes that so? I'm going way deeper than Jung, but what's going to happen is I'm going to keep going further and further down and saying there's something the same in all three of those, but they're in three different places. And if we're focusing on how the same could be the same, it seems like there's something that is exactly the same in all three places, but the same thing cannot be in three places at once. So basically, we have no idea how resemblance is possible. And we get to the problem it's distinguishable, it's separable. Notice one of the links was to the text that we have. So this is one of the issues. Do I want to get a PDF of this? It won't let me highlight it. Well, how does this whole problem frame itself? Well, if we're aware of the sensory ideas, if you will, the perceptions themselves, right, of the colors, I'm perceiving them as similar but in different places. What makes them similar has to be something that is the same. you get right down to it. But at the same time, the same thing can't be in three places at once. So if things can be distinguished one from the other, they must be separable and distinct. But what about partial resemblances that make up the differential resemblance? Then we end up with a problem. And we actually still have this problem too. Because if even in modern parlance we talk about the photons hitting the eye and the receptors picking it up, you know, the colors have to be the same. You know, the pixels or whatever have to be the same. And if that's, you know, the case, then my mind reacts to it the same way. What we have is a lot of same things going on that we have at least a logistics problem in dealing with, and that is, how can they be exactly the same in all of these different places? And another problem or aspect of this would be, like, so your mind sees blue, I presume? Your mind sees blue. We all think we see blue. Even the question, like, did the Greeks have colors like we do? Because in their ancient texts, the Homeric texts, they only had red, black, and white. Didn't they have blue? I mean, they even called the ocean wine red, which is dumb, because if you've ever seen the pictures, at least, or have been to Greece, their water is bluish, green, aqua, whatever, depending on the light, of course.
Well, blue isn't what is like the electromagnetic spectrum, which is visible light. You think it would be odd to think of it not being...
Yeah, we can't imagine that they couldn't actually see it, but they might not have known that they were seeing it. And if they didn't know, they didn't have the word for it.
Oh, yeah. It didn't exist because they didn't have a word for it.
One interesting argument is that, and this is in the book Through the Looking Glass of Language by Guy Deutscher.
So that kind of is like, if there is no word for a tree, is a tree real? Like, the same question.
Yes, yes. Wait, that's not it. That's the book that talks about the Greeks, and was actually one of the prime ministers of England who was a Greek scholar and noticed it. It was Disraeli. Maybe not Disraeli, I'm getting my names mixed up. But so, we know that different languages have different conceptions of blue. And then the question, like Russian, right, for example, has different blues. They don't really translate into our blues. We translate them, but it's a lie, right? So the cultural difference between those blues and the blues of our culture, or even French, right, it's not the same.
So if, like, something isn't linguistically, like, recognized, and it's not, like, technically real, can that, like, be applied to, like, morals, per se? Because, like,
oh,
before...
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. It applies
before,
to everything.
Yeah. Or, like, I don't know, it kind of reminds me of, like, a lot of Native Alaskan, like, tribes that are still indigenous. They have, like, something like 43 words for snow, but, like, for different types of snow. But, like, people who just speak English wouldn't really think of that. Unless, of course, you're, like, super into science, but, like... Those different snows don't really exist to us because we don't have that word for it.
There's Charles Woolforth talks about this somewhat in his book, The Whale and the Supercomputer. See, spent a lot of time with whalers in Barrow. And so the whale and the supercomputer in his book is the folklore that's been accumulated for thousands of years by the people. So that's, you know, and so how they know there's a whale, we should go out, etc. And it's kind of a critique of Western science not taking into account native science,
mm-hmm.
as equally valid, though very, very different, of course, in the way it gathers data, maybe. But so the problem, though, is how do we know what you're perceiving is the same as what I'm perceiving?
Right.
Regardless of the cultural differences and the language differences and the fact that your brain is not the same as my brain.
Right. So, like, if we switched bodies right now, would it be, like, the entire time I thought I was seeing blue is you're red kind of thing? Like, if we were to, like, switch places.
Probably not. But, I mean, how would we know?
Yeah.
We wouldn't actually know. I suspect that we're probably remarkably similar. Because evolution, machines developing similar ways.
You're saying that you two things in the same part of the same area can't resemble one another, because, correct? Am I on the right?
Well, they do.
They do resemble, but we don't know.
I think the solution is to say that they really aren't in three different places. They're all in one place. They're in our mind.
That's what I was going to say, because it's, they're in three different physical places, but then you kind of take that information, and then it becomes one.
The idea of spatial reality, in a way, is we realize, the problem is that we're thinking in terms of things being in space, but actually all of the things that are happening in my mind are in my mind.
Because at that point it's a memory of the couple.
Right. But that, of course, brings up all the issues associated with how can I know that the things that I'm experiencing are out there? Well, they're not necessarily out there. They could be just in my imagination. They could be dreams. They could be the Matrix. They could be, as Berkeley argues, the mind of God. Although Hume then points out that the mind of God is not a good answer because, it's not there because God doesn't exist. Or, as far as Hume is concerned, the proofs that you use to show that God exists. Although, the ontological argument, I don't think he touches that one. Kant will talk about that one, but the ones that Hume talks about is the causality argument that I mentioned, but since causality is dependent on our memories, that argument, how do you know? Boof, it just dissipates, it doesn't work, because it questions the whole necessity of cause and effect. But the other one that he argues against is the design argument. Everything is just absolutely so gorgeously interconnected and beautifully arranged. It had to be created by a great architect or designer who we all call God, right? And he goes, how do you know? He puts that into question. Which, in a way, certainly sets up the stage for Darwin later to come along and say that it could be evolution, right? Which, by the way, that doesn't work if Einstein is right and all time and space exists at once, because then all my ancestors are coexistent eternally with me. There's no predecessor in time and space, but we're coexisting. I'm not sure how evolution can be conceived of in that model, right? It seems like that would be in conflict with that all time and space existing at once. Can't have predecessors if they're all coexisting. What is that? Looks like a dead bird.
It's the fifth day of the Doodle Snow Games.
So why is there a dead bird in a Ike igloo?
I don't know.
Maybe he's sleeping.
If you click the little, yeah, it'll probably. If you click it, it'll probably.
What is that? How do you?
Oh.
It's moving.
Oh, it's a bear. Okay.
Oh, it's a hibernating bear.
Or a fox or something.
Bears don't have such a big fluffy tail.
Or it's something to do with the Olympics.
Yeah, bobsled.
Sorry.
It did look like a dead bird.
Yeah.
But we can all perceive it as blue, right?
Well, so what else about David Hume is important, though? Let me.
Have you seen that? It was like a viral thing like 1 or 2 years ago, that stupid dress, and it like, you see it as a different color depending on which part of it you see first.
Yes.
So everyone was like, it's gold, it's blue, but really it was like neither or both or something.
Now I have better notes you need. So the one issue that really becomes a persistent problem after Hume, and still today we would agree with this, I keep mentioning Thomas Metzinger as an individual that deals with it, and that's the problem of the self. Is there a persistent self? Barclay sets it up by saying, strictly speaking, we never see ourselves. Hume points out that, you know, the idea of a persistent self is dependent on my memory of myself from moment to moment, but actually I do change. All my cells change over time. I'm clearly not the same acute little kid that I was when I was born. Assuming you think that kids are cute when they're born. See a picture of me in the nude?
How are we supposed to answer that?
It was a setup, right?
It was a loaded question.
Yeah. Photos of me. There it is. Should be. Well, that's me when I was with my grandpa. Hey, where'd it go?
There is. There's one. Aww. I don't even think kids are cute, but that is a cute picture.
Yeah. Is it legal? I mean, it was then. What about now? I mean...
No. Wait. There's, like, a really, like, specific law regarding it, but I heard you can't even post pictures of your kids in bathing suits, like, nowadays.
What?
Yeah, yeah. If it's because it's suggestive or something.
Well, I think that's more of a, like, Facebook and social media policy than an actual.
Yeah.
It's me playing with my log cabin.
I've heard of that. People getting banned from posting a picture of their kid.
Yeah.
That's my grandpa.
I mean, like, what? There's so, every parent takes pictures of their
kid. Yeah. If anything, like the fact that they're like, you know, like weirdly sexualizing it, that's weirder than even like the pictures
themselves.
Yeah.
In fact, they're thinking about it that way.
Yeah. 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 It's, like, come on. It's a freaking baby.
Nice.
That's me on George.
Nice.
Actually, I just totally found that picture on the internet and just put my face on it.
It kind of looked like it.
Yeah, I can tell a little
you
bit.
You can tell?
Yeah.
Well, yeah. especially if you zoom in, I didn't even do it. I did like...
Oh, the cut thing.
I think there is a Hank the Moose that you can get on around here. Somewhere.
Yeah, yeah, my grandparents said that.
He shows up right
at the library
places.
Or something.
Yeah.
I like that photo a lot.
Of this one?
Yeah.
This is neat because it's the Euler? No, not Euler. The one that creates the stairs going up until you're going back down.
Oh. Aww.
That was actually me, believe it or not.
You said that was you?
That's me too. Both, yeah, all these are. High school.
You look so happy.
That's high school graduation. Stop. Cat's whip.
Nice hat.
Stumbledore's hat.
Oh,
that was pretty awesome.
I got it in Las Vegas. But see, it's me holding the globe that has a picture of, right, you know, and then I made it multiple times.
Mm-hmm.
But really, you can't know that you persist over time, but obviously we do. How do we know it? In what sense do we persist? And today you have folks like Thomas Metzinger saying that what we have are mental processes that are actually dependent on our cultural and linguistic programs installed on your brain, so that the concept of self that we have is different than, say, in Afghanistan. Not only because our language is different, the kind of programs you can run on English is different than Urdu or Pashtun or whatever. Pashtun or whatever, depending on where they are in Afghanistan. But also, we've grown up in a culture where individuals have rights. Our governmental legitimization narrative is based on we, the people, forming the government, contracting with one another, social contract. Have rights that will protect these. This is all an abstract set of ideas that don't exist actually in time prior to people like Locke, Hobbes, Locke, Rousseau, etc. And still don't, you know, in most of the world where people haven't read John Locke, they don't.
Perception of what year it is different. That was one thing I found amazing.
Oh,
like,
yeah?
Oh, it's
yeah.
Like 1504. What are you talking about? Because their calendar is based off an entire different system. So
yeah.
Where you, it's 2018, and they get very, very confused.
I think the Hebrew calendar is 5,000 something.
Yeah.
Right, because they don't start from zero.
Even the annual calendar is different if you're Islamic and you go by the lunar calendar. Ramadan comes at different times. I was so puzzled when they were like trying to figure out exactly when the moon would rise. I was like, can't you just look at the astronomical data and you would know exactly to the second that it arises? And yet they were like waiting to figure out when Ramadan would actually end. Because waiting for it to actually happen.
So they have to observe it.
Yeah, that seemed so passé. So. Huh. So 1711, 1776, that made him 65 when he died. Never literary attempt was more unfortunate than my treatise of human nature. It fell dead-born from the press. He was young, he was like 18 when he had this wonderful idea that he thought would totally change philosophy. And it was this idea that the memory fails us. It's not a source of knowledge. And so that's going to affect everything. And so he wrote this wonderful book, and he thought he was going to become like a hero, and no one read it. So he was very disappointed. He went to Europe. The French referred to him as the Bonnie David, even though he got in trouble there, because he's an atheist, and that's still a problem everywhere he goes. He uses his conception of perceptions, following John Locke, and those perceptions you can break up into the lively ones. Those are the perceptions that I feel sort of like I'm having now. But those can be dreams too. Like, so if I'm dreaming and I'm having a lively perception of a ghost coming down a corridor with chains dragging and, you know, Ebenezer, you know, or whatever, you know, I'm thinking, hey, that's real. Those are lively. But less lively would be the ideas, like if I'm definitely thinking of triangularity, that doesn't seem to be nearly as lively. It's all conceptual. But I think even concepts like my mom, so if I know that I'm not in the physical presence of my mom, but I'm thinking of my mom, I think that would also be considered less likely. But all my ideas are initially derived from impressions. So I don't have ideas or impressions that didn't get their start somehow from a physical entrance into my mind from experience, from empirical experience. Right? So my conceptions of colors come from teachers telling me this is red, this is blue, and me seeing, oh, you know, so like this is milk. You know, we even today we think of an awful lot of childhood learning as being observation statements. This is milk. Want more milk? Yes, that kind of thing. So observation statements. And those are the ones we can actually believe, right? By the way, I can't really even prove those. You know, so if I were to, you know, ask everyone here, are these glasses, you would all, I think, say yes. We would all agree, right? Because we're fluent speakers of the language, as far as I can understand what that means. Right? So we know to refer to this object as, it's in the plural. Because there are two of them, I suppose, right? Even though it's one object, it's a pair of glasses. Just didn't plan on making a mess out of that.
Oh, okay. Well, that makes sense, because eyeglass, like, or like a monocle?
It's just one.
Yeah.
Pair of pants. A pair of skirts. No. Skirt is just one.
Because there's not two legs, it's just a skirt.
Are there skirts?
Wait, what? Oh, yes. Yes. That would be whenever a skirt has a built-in under
shorts.
Shorts.
So
it's
skirt or skorts?
Skorts.
Because there's two.
Oh, God.
Oh.
Is it a skort? Or is it skorts? That's like...
I think it's like a skort.
It's like the most mind-racking
question. Short.
Shorts. You don't say...
Shorts. Skirt.
Sorry.
My sister lived in those for several years.
Skirt.
That's an important question. Oops.
A skirt. Yeah. It was actually one of the crossword puzzle answers today. Totally confused me, because the cross word was strobe, and I had skirt, so that would have made it strebe, And I was like, no, but it's strobe. Is there such a thing as a skirt? And I thought, well, being English, we can merge shorts and skirts and get a skirt. And sure enough, there they are. So that's fun. And now I'm totally lost. What was I?
So you would be kind of a blank slate kind of believer, because we're all,
yes,
all
so
ideas and perceptions.
So Locke,
we have no impressions.
Locke, in that sense, gives us the tabula rasa, the blank slate. Yes, and so Hume, as far as I know, agrees with that as well. The idea of God, for example, is mere extrapolation. I can think of things that don't really exist, like a unicorn, because I've seen single-horned animals. I've seen that impression, and I've seen horses. I've seen white horses. So I can imagine unicorns, dragons. But anything that I do imagine, he thinks, must have come from sense impressions that in some sense, even if they don't exist as a whole, entire set of impressions that you receive once, that you can actually take these impressions apart in your mind and rearrange them and create weird things. Obviously artists do, create new art, and so on. And the concept of God is kind of, for him, like that unicorn idea, in the sense that we have these really complex conceptions like omnipotence, omnibeneficence, omnipresence. I mean, God is everywhere, right? All the omnis, right? In fact, remember with Spinoza, you get an infinity of such characteristics, all of which are infinite, so that you end up then with a concept of God that's totally beyond our finite human ability to conceive. We're basically putting like a placeholder there, like the infinite itself. You know, we have a symbol for the infinite, but no one thinks of themselves as capable of actually imagining what the infinite really is. Like a chilagon is about this big. We can't even think of a chilagon. It's a thousand-sided figure. You can't conceive of that. Actually, I don't see why
we
can conceive of a circle.
Yeah, let's just be a circle.
It would be. Yeah, so why is Descartes like that? I don't know. Okay, so I used to have these on slides. They were like overhead, so I just copied them into. So that's why it says slide. So custom and habits of the mind. So we associate ideas in our minds. One of which, for example, is resemblance, which you talked about. Another one, contiguity in time or place. I mean, I think of all three, four of us. There's four of us here. Being in this room. So contiguity of time right now and space. But actually in my mind's perception, all of this is happening some sort of digital electrical world that could not actually, I mean, it might not be spatial. It's just perceiving it as spatial. How do I know? But that's the way I arrange things in my mind so that I can practically do things. And Hume is very practical. Remember, his main arguments are against those philosophers that think they've demonstrated certainty, metaphysics. No, they haven't. But practically speaking, he's a Scot. He's into practicality. He thinks that, you know, practical, pragmatic things are great. There's actually a Scottish a pragmatic school, you know, that the common sense school for the Scots, which certainly isn't a problem for him. I mean, this is the way the Scots. You know, so they're. It's kind of interesting. This is their response to David Hume, but David Hume would, I think, feel perfectly at home with that. Because Scott, because Hume isn't trying to say we can't know stuff. He's trying to say the philosophers who think they have certitude are wrong. So his arguments are aimed at them, not at the practical, everyday kind of things that people do. So we talked about cause and effect, relations of ideas, and matters of fact. So the unmarried male is a bachelor. Red is not blue. So definitions, etc. Or logical things like you are either here or you're not here. That's a true statement. You are both here and not here. That is false. Right? And so if I say it's not the case that you are both here and not here, that's true. Right? It's not the case that you are both here and not here. That's false. So it's not the case. That, right? It's the same as saying it's false. So that's true. And all that we know for sure. It's logically impossible. I mean, that's where logical impossibility is. Abstractions. They're abstractions. They're not dependent on actually knowing whether you're here or not. Regardless of whether you're here or not, the statement that you are either here or you are not is true. Because they're the contradiction of one another, and if I'm claiming that either the one is true or the other is true, that combined or compound statement is true. But that's a relation of ideas. The first intuitive or demonstrably certain, and the second is founded on cause and effect. I'm not sure what I was talking about there. Matters of fact. Comes only from experience. I think this will help with that. So talking about cause and effect. The mind has never anything present to it but the perception. So everything that I'm perceiving isn't something that's outside of my perceptions. The perceptions are all I'm experiencing. Even if they're dreams, actually I can't really tell. That's why that's an interesting puzzle. You know, one seems more lively than the other, more resistant to change. You know, like, you know, in a dream I could put my hand through the book. Whoa, how did that happen? But here I can't do that. So I cannot possibly reach any experience of my perception's actual connection with objects. Because I'm solipsistically, is the word, trapped within my own experience. So this is also called solipsism. Have it on there, but if you look up the word solipsism, I would have expanded on it a little bit more than that, but you're trapped within your own mind.
Wait, can you go back to that?
yeah, you can't deny this. But remember, Descartes thought that you could get out of it by saying, ah, and I have the idea of a perfect God. That could only have been caused by God. So that was his open the door, ah, the world is out there. But David Hume clearly destroys that.
But there's like no way to know that, like, right now I'm not like rocking back and forth in an insane asylum and this is all just some weird like mental disorder. Like, there's no way to like actually
in fact you are in an insane asylum, and the reason we're talking is because your mom asked me to stop by and say hi to you today.
Yeah, exactly.
Just kidding, she didn't ask me.
Okay.
Reason is as much a matter of habit as emotion. Oh, and do I have it on here somewhere? Maybe not. Great expression by David Hume, a famous line, was that reason is the slave of the passions. What? Oh, I wasn't. So what did he mean? So, say I get into an argument over morals. Where do my morals come from? Well, they, as far as he's concerned, he's a communitarian. Let me draw this on the board. I think I've drawn parts of it before. This is what I call my cognitive map. So we have like a map. Four directions, certainty, uncertainty. And I have the self, the I, and the we. So I put Hume over here, and that makes him a communitarian. So Aristotle, did you say something? Yes? No. So Aristotle, and over here, virtue ethics. Down here I put John Stuart Mill, who we'll be doing, and Kant I put up here. We enter in here, at birth. This is all just, you know, my root. In the U.S., we kind of go this way. But Hume's argument on where ethics, morals come from, is from the community's passions or the community's ethics, so that your mom teaches you what's right and wrong. If dad teaches you that your job as a young man is to grow up and slice the heads off of your enemies, and the more of them you kill, the better off you are, etc., and the women will love you much more for that, right? Then you want to be the best hero that the community has ever seen, right? You know, because that's what dad expects of you, etc., etc. So each community has its own kind of communal ethics, ethos, will, that for Hume seems to be kind of, you might say it, evolutionarily developed, depending on where the community is. Right. Then we have logic, And if you really study logic and you get your argumentation down pat, you are going to be able to argue for all sorts of things. But you will not be able to persuade someone to give up their passion, their emotional attachment to the values. So if you really value killing the enemy, a pacifist isn't going to be able to persuade you to give that up. At least not according to you. In a way, it seems over time that this has changed, obviously. That in some sense, we've expanded our sense of who is a member of the community that we care about, perhaps through literature. That's actually a great book by Steven Pinker, Better Angels of Our Nature. Which is a quote from Lincoln, which is a quote from the Bible. But I get lost where it goes to from there. The Better Angels of Our Nature. I think Lincoln got it from the Bible. The idea of it is that we are actually getting better morally.
I think we talked about this on one of our first lectures, about like human
ideas. It's really impressed me. Because the news media, just this blew up and this crashed and the terrorists blew this up and another 150 dead here and stuff. And you think, wow, this is just worse all the time. Well, he points out that, that's how the news media sells newspapers and gets your interest in TV shows. We can't spend the whole day watching cat videos. Or cars in space. so we end up with all this news media promoting how horrible everything is, and that impresses us with the overall calamities that we're faced with. Everything seems so tragic. Heck, young people grow up feeling depressed because, wow, the world is, why do I want to have children? It's just going to be terrible for them. Well, actually, this is the best time ever. Statistically, we have more wealthy people, more people with longer lives, more health, more food, more you name it.
But we're also more aware, so that kind of takes a toll on things. As far
but the
as
prices to Walt Disney World have gone up.
Oh, yeah. That's probably it.
$500 for a family of four for one day pass.
Wow.
Can't you rent a hotel room in one of the the ones on Disney World, and then you don't have to have a pass because you're already there, or not? I don't know.
Expanding on that topic though, because it kind of reflects the ignorance is bliss sort of thing, because when people are dumber, they're more happy, and as we become more empathetic and civilized, becoming aware of all that is just kind of making everyone sad, I guess. I mean, it kind of makes sense.
You mean the negative news?
No, I guess just being more aware, because we're more of a, it's kind of a, we're more aware of what's
we're
going on.
We're connected to the news all
the
time.
Yeah.
It seems to be a turning point with people they think they're aware of a lot, but then they're truly not in the grand picture versus living with the plague versus, the flu outbreak we have now, saying it's the worst of times now.
So here's maybe we can make this a quiz question. So this online news, in English, clearly for Americans, is the Russian version of news. You could go to Russian too if you want to listen to it in Russian. There's a lot. I mean, I could go live and listen to them broadcasting in English.
The American movie producer Arnon Milchan, in this specific incident, Netanyahu supported the passing of a tax break, even named in Milchan's name, which basically grants tax breaks to Israelis who spend time overseas and then return to the country.
Peace that will burn during the Olympics or even after the Games. Their hope is that the United Korean team will show that people can work together and eventually overcome their divisions.
Al Jazeera.
I don't think the relationship between the South and the North will get better anytime soon.
Why are the
Many
Russians
things may happen,
in trouble
even in the future.
For
But I want to let people know that there is a positive side to our relationship.
Facebook and Twitter to try to influence our elections.
Takaya Kawasaki, NHK World,
Why is Russia in trouble for the way they tried to influence our elections?
One more time.
It is time now for
Why is Russia in trouble?
Meteorologist Carly Gomez.
At least
Good morning, Carly.
Being criticized
on the massive storm system in the South
for trying
Pacific,
to influence our election.
How severe is the system?
If you think about it, the BBC, the British tried to do it through the BBC and everything else. The French tried to do it. Everyone tries to influence our elections.
And is now starting to move out on Wednesday, but we're seeing the storm system now upgraded to a Category 5 severe tropical cyclone. This is Vida. Now it's moving west, northwest, about 15 kilometers per hour.
This is
still a very strong storm system and has been intensifying.